how do people function within an intact natural landscape, and is it possible to meet human needs and natural resource needs? I think the Adirondacks is a place where we can say, yes, it is possible.
When you look at this landscape, if you take a step back, it is so intact, it is so big.
The Adirondacks are considered a conservation model for other places across the globe because we are a park. We're big, we have amazing natural resources, but we also live here.
Where a stream and a road meet, what is the relationship going to be between those two things? Are they going to be one of respect? Well, the only way they become one of respect is if we plan it and build it and manage it to respect the stream.
So a culvert is a structure that occurs where a road and a stream meet. A bad culvert is too small. It can restrict where the water flows. It often creates flooding and debris jams. A good culvert lets a stream be a stream. It is big enough and wide enough. It will enable a fish to be able to move upstream. And it lets the stream flow, pass material, anything a natural stream would do, a good culvert will let that stream do.
In terms of the northeastern woodlands, there is no more characteristic or meaning-laden species than the brook trout.
Brook trout need to be able to use all of their habitat.
And a culvert will allow them to go from one place to the next. But it has to be constructed in such a way to facilitate that movement.
The ability of the trout to move at will be central to its survival. It will become more central as global warming progresses and the waters get warmer farther upstream.
Climate change is affecting a lot of our rivers and streams. We have seen an increase in extreme storm events. So what that means is that we need to be thinking about making our culverts bigger.
Well, Hurricane Irene came and it virtually separated this area from the rest of the world because you couldn't get here. The bridges were all blown out. And culverts play a major part of protecting bridges, protecting neighborhoods, protecting homes.
It's very important to keep these roads open. People live on this road. Tourists travel this road. Any road closings can cause a lot of problems.
In Irene, we had a quarter of a mile of the road washed out, and it took us 3 months to get everything back to where it was supposed to be.
It was really overwhelming to see homes and businesses literally moved down the river. We were so lucky to not lose lives, but we lost a lot of livelihoods.
I think the biggest challenge that municipalities see when they start thinking about improving culverts is the cost. When a culvert fails, the structure is usually damaged beyond repair. The road is destroyed.
The extent of the damage can be astronomical.
If you start really tallying up those costs, it's really a no-brainer to put in the right size of structure from the beginning. We really need to be thinking outside our traditional boxes in order to implement more projects like this going forward. We need to be thinking about climate change and climate adaptation. We need to be thinking about transportation. We need to be thinking about resiliency. We need to really explore all angles and think about all the different benefits that projects like this achieve. We spend a lot of time talking with municipal leaders and highway departments to get a sense of what their priorities are. And then we were able to overlay that information with the environmental information we'd already gathered to start to identify the highest priority crossings for replacement.
The cost share model that we've been using is where lots of different partners contribute resources to get good culverts done.
We bring together our different sources of funding and we also bring together our expertise.
We have very small towns and their budgets for transportation are really small.
We've seen evidence that these improved culverts really save money in the long term. So we put in a structure and it will now last 100 years. That's a pretty good investment.
What it starts with is actually evaluating what the stream looks like before anything is done and understand what that natural system is, because what you want to do is rebuild that whole natural stream underneath the road and then put a cap over it.
And what that's going to do is this road crew is never going to have to come out and maintain this.
So it's sustainable for local infrastructure because it's more effort to put it in, but it's a much more long-standing project.
This cost share model is really going to be the way to see more projects like this happen into the future.
The long-term goal for this work is that fish and climate-friendly culverts become business as usual.
I've spent my whole career doing construction, so seeing something come together like this, where we've done more than just fix a culvert, it's very fulfilling to me. It's something that you tell your kids about rather than just, well, I went to work today.
We are hoping that through these demonstration projects, we will be able to figure out the process, streamline it, and then export these lessons to other geographies.
Improving culverts is not the only solution, but it's an important one, and it's one that is tangible and one where we can really make a difference.
So the world is seeking tangible projects that we can actually do something about, and I think these culvert projects represent something that is good for people, good for nature, and an example of something that we can actually do.